I'm not sure we have room for too many more.
Don't know who Blue Sky is or what we are, we're a nonprofit photography gallery. We've been here 41 years. Our shows rotate monthly, so every first Thursday is a new body of work on the wall. So come back if you want to know what's coming up each month. We have an email list you can sign up for over on the front desk. So, and that's like twice a month email. We're not like killing you with daily emails about things. I also want to say that Ervin's show is part of a larger series entitled Embodied Asserting Self. So it features six different artists from across the world, from across the US and the world. And they're all using the photographic medium to explore questions of self, belonging, and identity. So it actually had a soft start last month with Lauren Sullivan's work. And we're trying to sort of just provide extra awareness and activity. Oh, see, I told you there would be people. So we're just trying to give extra awareness to these artists and to this series and to sort of engage in dialogue around contemporary photography and again, this looking at self through photography. So it's a really exciting series. I'm also really happy to announce that we have a lead sponsor, and that's Jordan Schnitzer and our lead Schnitzer. And then there's a website for it, embodiedbluesky.org, so you can go there and check them all out. You can look at our Instagram and our Facebook too. Lastly, I wanted to say that Ervin's book, you can see over there, is already sold out, but fear not, and you can get it on the NASA cloud, and there's instructions right next to the book about how to do that. So please do that, includes the images that you see here today, and also several others, so you can get a fuller sense of the body part. So I just have a quick little bios, and then I'll leave it to you guys. So Ervin A. Johnson was born and raised in Chicago, graduated from the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. With a bachelor's degree in rhetoric, and subsequently completed his second bachelor's degree at Columbia College Chicago in photography. Most recently, he graduated with his MFA in photography from Savannah College of Art and Design in Georgia, and has exhibited work from this series at the Arnica Dawkins Gallery in Atlanta. Ashley Stoll Myers is a writer, editor, and curatorial collaborator. She's curated exhibitions and programming for the Wattis Institute in San Francisco, the Luggage Store in San Francisco, the Oakland Museum of California, and space here in Portland. She's a recurring contributor to The Daily Serving, The Exhibitionist, and Arts Black, and has written for Bomb Magazine, Rhizome, and SFAQ/NYAQ. And she currently serves as the Artist in Residency Program at C3 here in Portland.
Thanks everyone for coming. This is a very full room. I'm really excited about the congratulations on that. Before we jump into the nitty-gritty of some of this work and how it's made, I think we should contextualize why it was made. So I want
finishing up my MFA at dad. I would go home every summer, and I'm from Chicago. And particularly, and I think this is on the artist that the Trayvon Martin case was ending, and it's the final day of the trial. And I was in my room because I had just had enough of it. I couldn't watch anymore. And I didn't want to see what the work was, because I kind of had an idea of what it was going to be. So I tuned that. But my mom, who's here today, walked into the room crying. And we didn't speak any words in that moment, but I kind of got a sense of why she was so distraught. And then a couple months later, we finally had a conversation about. And she told me that she felt hopeless as a mother and helpless. And that kind of echoed my feelings throughout my experience as a gay black man. When I talk about this work, I talk about being self-aware and about my work in general. I've always been self-aware of what it means to exist as a gay black man and the consequences of that. So that was the genesis of it. After that, I returned back to SCAD. And while simultaneously finishing up my MFA, I decided to embark into this work. I had been thinking of ways to make these images, but it was always on the back burner. It didn't really ever seem that important. And that was because also, I never really felt like I had a voice or that anything that I had to say would matter. The idea behind this work specifically is that it's meant to exist in multiple venues and in multiple ways. So the hashtag is a nod to the millennial generation and how I feel like lots of movement and change happens via social media. And that's the idea behind what I'm doing specifically with these art pieces, is that I want them to move off of the walls and exist online. As you just mentioned, I also repasted in Atlanta and recently in Chicago. I've placed actual live paintings on street walls. And that's just all about moving the work out. Because for me as a child, I never really felt comfortable in settings like this. I never felt welcomed. And art never really seemed like an option. And that's no fault to my mother and father, who really did everything they could to push me out into art. It's just really not a welcoming place. I don't feel. So yes, this work is meant to exist in multiple ways, and so far it has.
Yes, and that's great. You talk a little bit about Black Lives Matter and kind of this era of Trayvon Martin and Mike Brown, and Black Lives Matter started as a hashtag. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really interesting and a nice conceptual parallel that in honor of exists as a hashtag. Are you finding that people have taken the hashtag places? Is it mostly just sharing your work, or have you seen any other instances where people are now starting to think about honoring Black bodies and Black images through hashtags and lots of other images?
The hashtag is picking up, and oddly for me, it's happening very quickly. I've been working on the work for 2 years now, and it's very different from what you see. This is the first iteration. But yeah, there has been a pickup. There was an Instagram account that has about 30,000 followers. Every posted one image, and from that I gained about 500 followers. So it's working in the way that I want to, probably not as fast as I thought that it would, but the work is picking up traction.
Yeah. I looked at it and I saw some other works that were collage
my head is packed with ideas and ways of working. And this, like I said, this is the first way. So these are one layered images of paintings and photography. Now, I think my newest work is about 4 or 5 different layers. And then collage photo work.
So now that we're talking about collage, let's get into how these things are made. That's really important to unpack and to talk about. So my first question is, who are these people? Do you know these people, or where do you source these images?
Going back to social media, I sent out a blast, a Facebook invite to a photo session that I was having. I told everyone my intention for the work and what I wanted to talk about, and who showed up was most of my SCAD community. So all of these are SCAD students. And we sat there and we had conversations about the work and my intentions, and then also their feelings about the Black Lives Matter movement. At that point, I hadn't begun to work out ways of working, so they didn't know what was to come. But
yeah.
Yeah.
So, what is it fair to say that, in small part, the way this work was born is from those conversations that you were having in those studios, that you had a broader conversation about this thematic thing that you wanted to do, this conversation that you wanted to have around police brutality or Blackness Matter, the way that Black bodies were represented? Did having those conversations influence the way some of this started to manifest?
Yes. But the conversations weren't fresh, mm-hmm. if that makes sense. These are conversations that I don't think are new to people, especially the people that I photograph, which are other Black people. Nothing that we were saying to each other was something that we hadn't already discussed. It was just moving those feelings into something tangible.
Right, and it was SCAD, which is in South Savannah. Did that have any particular effect working on this work in the South, where those dynamics of there's a different sort of tension in the South? So did we at SCAP and working with the cohort at SCAP have any sort of influence on the depth of the conversation or the ways that they really do be
Yes, perhaps in a way that I would not have liked. The conversations at SCAD and art school period seem to focus on technique,
mm-hmm.
and not the idea behind it, because people don't seem to be comfortable delving into these topics.
Mm-hmm.
None of the critiques that I ever had in undergrad or during my master's program were centered around ideas of Blackness. It was always about the technique and about the after product being something beautiful, which was the intent, but mm-hmm. I wanted people to understand why I had to get there in the first place.
Right, which is really strange because SCAD's museum used to be a railway
mm-hmm.
depot. So like, there's this whole, for anyone that doesn't know, Savannah College Art Design, the museum on that campus used to be a railway depot, so it has a very different, it has a lot of history around the slave trade and tobacco and indigo and things that were moving through this railway depot, which is kind of what I was getting at. Being at SCAD and making work like this with your cohort seems like a very powerful place and time to be having some of these conversations. So you do know these people and they were your cohort. So now I want to ask you literally how these are made, because the language you have around this talks a lot about getting the pigment from skin and then putting it back. So can you talk a little bit about the literal process of that, but also
So the literal process is printing the photograph out, and specifically for these, after that, it's about interacting with it in a way that mimics my emotions about being Black, and then also emotions about violence against the Black body. And during my research for my thesis, I came across a movement called abstract expressionism that I felt really reflected my feelings towards body work. that requires that you are physically expressive on campus or whatever your chosen medium is. So then, after I print them out, the first act is to be violent towards the thing. And after that, I go back and I rework the pigment. I add skin tones that I found, particularly in that person, then just also throughout the Black experience, onto one person, and then the after product is this thing that's meant to, not meant to, that does exist despite the violent act. So it's about being resilient. Mm-hmm. And it's not, the end object is about resilience again, not violent act.
Right.
If that makes sense.
So there's the beginning stages of it, there's a sort of, on some conceptual level, sort of reenactment of, if not violence, at least erasure, taking away the skin color. And then there's the act of resilience and rebuilding and kind of recreating on top of that. When you're doing that, are you trying to recreate the tones and the pigments and the way that the skin originally was, or are you, is that the expression somewhere, are you changing? Do you have any concern for maybe putting people back together the way, exactly the way that they looked before?
Yes and no. These were specifically created during the exact specific violent acts. Some of them are here, but for instance, I'm having a hard time recalling her name. The young woman who was held in police, she was held standard by. I created a piece specifically during that time, and specifically when Trayvon was arrested. So this first iteration, I would wait until something happened, which I thought would take a long time, but it ended up being a couple times a week. So these are heavy in that way that they carry the weight of a tangible event.
Right. That says a lot to me about the size of the series, and that kind of actually gives me the heebie-jeebies a little bit. Like the size of the series. Do you have plans for the series to be finite, or do you feel like you will keep making them as long as you keep having these instances to sort of feed off of?
I made a vow to myself that the work would continue until the acts ended.
Mm-hmm.
I honestly see no end.
Right.
Currently.
Your life's work suddenly.
Yeah. That's heavy.
Yeah, that's very heavy.
I talk about it, it's already saying whatever I'm saying. issues that fuel the work.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I feel like with people that I've considered closest friends that know me, that know why I'm making this work, we never enter into a conversation about it.
Mm-hmm.
And that bothers me.
Right.
For me, the work has to exist in every way possible, visually. It has to exist in spaces like this where I have access to you all who might not have ever encountered me anywhere else other than this type of space. But then also it has to exist for the people that I make it for, which is why I place it on the South and everywhere in Chicago, and every city that I can get to. It has to exist in every way so that everyone can encounter it, so that everyone touched by it, so that conversations can happen. And even if it's not a conversation, even if the only thing that you walk away with is an idea or a changed sentiment that you held before that, that's enough.
What reaction have you gotten from the people that you use as models once they see, if you even had any reaction from them, once they see the ways that they have been changed by this?
They're usually shocked. My best friend is here somewhere hiding, probably. Nikki, where are you? This is her portrait behind the center portrait.
Yeah.
So I feel like she could probably speak to that. Nikki, how do you feel? Well, I can tell you that we came in for the Thursday night opening. We were just walking around, and we ended up here, and we walked in, and she walked across the threshold and immediately ran back and had a little moment, a teary moment outside.
Yeah.
Also, I received emails from the staff here, and they experienced a similar instance.
Yeah.
I work out of my family's basement, and sometimes the work is heavy and I have to step away for a couple days or a week. And whenever I re-enter that space, and I talk a lot about my work in a sacred space, where I create the work is a sacred space. And I will also have those type of moments. When I first started as a fine artist, I started from a very singular place, and it was all about me trying to flesh out understanding, like, my existence and how, if at all, I contribute to everything. So I still have those. It's very rare that a self-portrait happens, but if it does, it's at an important junction in my life. So if I do that, it's about figuring something out about
potentiality for visual art in a political moment? That's a very big question. Mm-hmm. But I guess as an artist with a practice, when you're responding to politics or a certain social zeitgeist in a moment, I feel like whether it's like an overt intent or not, I always feel like there's something about that that's a little bit hopeful. Channeling your makership into something that you want people to see or engage with. And I feel like as an act, there's something about that that has a hope or an idea for the way that an audience will be affected. So can you talk a little bit about that and your decision to make work in this hyper-politicized moment?
Like I said, I'm really selfish in a sense that it's about figuring me out with the hope that other people can draw from that. My earlier work is specifically about navigating my queerness, my queer blackness, which can't be like those two things are not separate. So it's always about that first, and then again, I made a vow to myself that I made a vow to the creator that if this is my gift, that that I'd be able to use it in a way that no one, if I could create visual work that could keep other people from feeling the way that I felt when I was younger, that would be enough for me. So I can't say that my main goal is to like tear down the machine, but if I can get people to know that they aren't alone and that they can also find power in themselves, that's what it's really about for me. I made the work because I felt powerless, and it's all about seeing the beauty in myself and then letting people know that also that the beauty and power lies within, no matter how corny that may seem. There's a hierarchy of work and ways of working in that time that I wasn't aware of.
So it's procedural first.
Yes. But then also, under that, it was the comments that I was like, were not about our procedures. It was about this is the place for you to say that type of thing. And my reaction to that was everywhere is the place to say this type of thing.
Yeah.
If I can't walk into a house that my parents and family have owned for 28 years without being stopped by the police and called a black faggot, then where is the proper place for me to object that?
I mean, it's public space, so without being intimately familiar with this tunnel, it's a tunnel. So that's very strange.
glad to see your work, and it's so powerful, especially knowing a lot of these people from SCAD. It's so powerful to see how they've been altered, and to see how this body of work has grown. And a question from that is that I feel like as an artist who's Black, there's this constant, I feel like, inner conflict that I experience, feeling like obligated to talk about the issues versus am I actually passionate about this, or is this what I want to be making? And I just wonder if you feel that conflict as well, and I feel like just by virtue of being an artist of color, that's kind of the burden, and maybe it's a blessing too, but I just want to know if you can speak to that, because,
despite my parents' best efforts, I had a very interesting childhood, and because of that, I've always felt like I had to be bold in my queerness and in my Blackness, because those things were always challenged for me personally. So for me, it's not a burden, it's necessary for me. I'm not speaking for everyone, but I will take the burden of speaking for everyone. It's a welcome challenge. I understand that I can't and that that's not my obligation, but my work, I don't foresee not making work about being queer and Black, because those are the things that I cling to as far as identity goes.
I think every artist makes work without having the burden of it being considered identity work. I feel like white male artists don't have to justify their whiteness and maleness in the things that they make. That's just reality as a person. So being a Black artist and making work with that in mind to various degrees, I think, is not something that you have to have a thesis about. That's your reality. I think that's the reality of lots of this work in this time. To as a Black artist, making work about your reality is something that you're just going to do by trade of
wondering, and this city and this state have a horrible but quieter racist history. I'm wondering if you could speak to kind of the role of a show like this in a city with a pretty racist history and a racist bias and racist police, and what you feel like the importance of this show is. I'm sorry, I know that's a really complicated deep question.
It's everywhere I go. Like,
photographs of a combo in this pink color palette from this neat expired film. And he taught the thing he says that's so lovely is that beauty is the sharpest tool in the box. And then we really want people to see something, feel it, you know, for it to really make a deep emotional impact. If we do it in a beautiful way, it works more, you know. So the issue gets across more.
Called yourself a photographer who is also an artist, or even an artist that includes photography in your work. And is the photography of this work a foundation for the work, or is it part of the work? Where does this poet, or do you make those kinds of distinctions? Like, do you see visual art as visual art, or
it's interesting.
As photography as a medium, as an art form itself, playing to your personal vision?
I consider myself a fine art photographer, but it was interesting in the way that she spoke, and correct me if I'm wrong, it sounded like you were separating photography from art.
Not at all. I think I was trying to be able to discover both my language.
I call myself an artist and activist. am I asking? I feel like, or did you? Is there something else that you're asking?
You can tell me if I am wrong. Are you wondering if he considers himself more of a photographer or a painter, or whether that distinction?
Let me ask. Sure. It is that how much does photography play into your work? Is it the foundation of the work and your initial vision, or then you fall along that? Or is photography just part of something that you thought about? Maybe you thought about the splashes before you thought about the image and how you make people. Given that this is a photo gallery, I just wondered how you place photography in your art.
Photography is the basis, it's the foundation. I'm exploring lots of mediums, but photography for me is important, and specifically because it provides you with the ability to snatch a moment of time and deem it as singularly important. And to do that with black faces is important. And then to be able to merge that with a medium that doesn't really represent lots of colored people, and merge those two things and then elevate blackness is important to me.
Good, thank you.
It can take anywhere from a week to... So at the beginning, if I was very quick with the production, now I find myself doing things. So I'll do things. All of these feel like experiments. There are things that I find successful and one that I don't find successful in others. So from that, I've learned to slow down and make conscious decisions because I don't ever go into a portrait knowing what I want the end result to be. But there are things that I enjoy, so I'll take those things from other things. And now I'm slowly. So I'll spend about a month now on one. but yeah, they all feel different. So I think it's just about being like close to the work. But yeah.
Well, thanks for this conversation. It's been really interesting to hear you both go back and forth. There was not any pauses where I wasn't thoroughly engaged. I'm thinking about these images being translated from this moment of black death and violence against black bodies. And then being turned into objects in a commercial art gallery or as prints for sale. And I'm wondering about how they would be contextualized outside of the series and outside of this very thoughtful statement that you put forward. And I'm thinking about if you, in making them as an artist and then essentially knowing that they may have a home elsewhere, if you've imagined situations in which they'd be posited in a way that is either counter to your original intentions or ways in which they would further your original intentions in making artwork?
There was an artist talked to this guy about 2 or 3 years ago, Kennedy Wiley. And he was talking about his paintings existing, where they end up existing. And what was really interesting to me is that he didn't see a negative because of his original intent. And that I really connected with that because I feel like as long as whatever my intent is, which I've revealed to you all today, it doesn't matter where it is existing. And for me, it's like it's interesting where this work ends up, because it's never where I imagined it going as far as like buyers or collectors. But it feels like a win, because now there's this piece that's specifically about this one thing existing in this place that I never thought that it would, and then the conversations have to happen about that piece now, somewhere that they probably wouldn't have happened before. So for instance, a collector in Atlanta purchased one of the first portraits of this work that I ever did. He says that whenever he has dinner parties, just because of how alluring that piece is, conversations start about it, and then he tells them what it's about. And then now they're having conversations about the Black Lives Matter movement at his dinner party. So for me, that's a way. Because I feel like I can't be there. I might not ever be invited to the house to have that conversation. But I'm represented by this thing that I made. It's very I've had a conversation with the gallerist about that, and she thought that it would draw more attention to the work. I'm not particularly, I feel like that might be a bit disrespectful. So I've never even made a mention of that.
This might be along the same lines. This might be very far away from your intent, but initially when I saw the show, I saw it more as an interactive show with an auditory element. For me, when I've seen these instances on social media of actual footage from police cars or family members filming incidents, hearing what is happening during these confrontations has just been bone chilling to me in an auditory sense. And so I immediately thought, what if someone was viewing this work while hearing the police tapes for some auditory element of these instances? I don't know if that would be too representational.
I'm interested in moving you outside.